the Spot Track Podcast, talking sports contracts, the salary cap, and business of sports.
Welcome into the latest edition of the Spot Track Podcast. Brandon Kravitz here, along with the money man himself, fresh off of his full breakdown of the NFL schedule release. It is Mike Ginnitti. The NFL and these teams never cease to amaze me. A pretty entertaining end of NFL schedule release night.
Yeah, here's my question, right? So we spent a lot of the time going team by team. Phenomenal, by the way, right? I love the social drops. When are the platforms going to do a drop? Because now these platforms all have their own scheduled games, right? So Netflix has these two games. They should be having fun with this. They should be having fun with the four teams that they're going to be broadcasting on Christmas Day and putting themselves in this conversation. Why aren't we getting as much content as humanly possible on a Wednesday in the middle of May, right? It's the NFL. So I actually feel like not enough. I know that I'm tongue in cheek here, but you know, there's going to be more coming. This thing's just spreading out. I know you want to get to it. What are there, seven platforms now broadcasting the NFL in 2024, Brandon?
So if I have the number, but as far as the platforms, I'm going to try and do this off the top of my head. YouTube TV.
Yep.
That's where you get the NFL ticket or Red Zone or both. I haven't taken the plunge, by the way, with the NFL ticket. I'm a YouTube TV subscriber. I swear by it. So good. But I've still stuck on Red Zone. I might actually make the change this year. Red Zone's great. It does create a little bit of monkey brain. So, okay, well, that's one. YouTube TV, you got Peacock, obviously, has gotten into the mix. They have playoff games now. Amazon Prime with the Thursday night game. You've got ESPN Plus, I think, is still involved. Last year, it's ESPN Plus / Disney Plus. That's how you had to get the Toy Story game. And yep. Then you've got Netflix is involved now with Christmas. I'm up to five.
Yeah,
and I'm sure that I'm leaving somebody out.
Yeah, so the podcast, right? So the NFL Network and then your standard CBS Fox. So that's where this 272 regular season schedule comes from. It's pretty wild.
And so they're making money hand over fist. I mean, the NFL is far and away the most popular sport in this country. I'm not telling you anything that you don't already know. Mm-hmm. But are they putting too much of a financial strain on their customers? You know, I'm going to find it. I already have I think I already have all of the streaming packages that they are putting games on. So this is kind of an easy transition for me personally. But yep. Look, not everybody out there works in sports media or is as obsessed. And some people, you know, they've got a budget. I get it. $855 per year to watch every single NFL game.
Yeah. And is that including the Sunday ticket or not? It is.
It is.
Yeah. Look, it might even be more at the end of the day, because you remember what happened with YouTube after they launched the ticket in the Red Zone. I think the price is jacked up about 6 months later. So it's just going to be an ever-growing, evergreen type situation, because this is an absolute ratings monster. And it's the one situation where I can't really do anything about it, right? Like, we're always going to watch. There's always going to be a compelling situation, even if it's week eight, week nine. You know, I promised myself I wouldn't turn on Amazon this past year and watch Thursday Night Football. I think I still watched half of them. I was suckered into half of them. They just got us, right? And they know it, because yep. They throw this thing on anytime, any place, on any network or any platform, and we're in. So the international part of this now is growing exponentially. It just seems like a steamroller. I don't know that they can get to a point where there's too much, though. That is a conversation, right? I mean, they're pretty much taking down every day of the week at some point in time through the upcoming season. So we'll see if there's a, you know, a Tuesday lull for the NFL. I just don't see it happening, because everything we've seen is this is a bulletproof type league in terms of television ratings.
You know, the good news is with these streaming platforms is they let you get out of the deals very easily. So
yeah, you can go month to month. Yeah.
Exactly. So I would say to anybody that's annoyed by this is just view it that way. Look mm-hmm. at that game. Okay. If there's a game coming up on Peacock that you want to watch, it's going to cost you $7 to watch that game.
Pay for the month. Absolutely. Absolutely.
And then cancel it. If you don't want to watch it, then don't sign up for that month. And you can use that across platforms. Look, if you're busy on Christmas, as a lot of people are, You've got stuff to do. Don't sign up for Netflix. You know, yeah. So that's the counterpoint is, okay, yes, you can be annoyed by it, but the NFL is now a little bit a la carte. And so it's still going to be expensive. There's no way around that if you want to watch the NFL, but you don't have to watch every NFL game.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like it's going to happen. Right? I think they know exactly what they're getting into.
As a disclaimer, but I will be watching every NFL game. Where are you at, by the way, in terms of, as I've been having this debate with myself, I don't know why. Maybe it was because this past year I'm a YouTube TV subscriber, and that was before they added the Sunday ticket. So I never even really thought about having Sunday ticket since I've been controlling my own bills. I had it years ago when I lived with my sister when I was in college and stuff, but the NFL Red Zone channel takes care of all of my work for me.
Yeah.
Yet this past year, I kind of found myself going, am I actually watching enough football? I had that thought for the first time in my adult life where I went, yes, I'm seeing everything that happens, but am I actually watching football games? What do you do? How do you handle trying to consume as much as possible on an NFL Sunday?
I don't watch Red Zone. I appreciate it. I absolutely love that as a moniker for sports. And I think we're going to get more of it, by the way. It sounds like plenty of other sports are trying to adopt some version of it for their upcoming seasons here. I'm with you. I don't need that headache because I will pick and choose after the fact what I want to go back and kind of deep dive on. I would rather sit with the broadcast networks and kind of go through those games, have some of the halftime highlights. I'm certainly on the Twitter sphere for most of Sundays and certainly Monday nights, keeping up with whatever else the rest of the country is talking about. So I just sort of pick and choose how I'm going to red zone my weekends with this sport instead of having it all thrown at me at one time, because it really can be overwhelming. There's a hell of a lot going on, especially if you've got like an 11 game, 1 p.m. slot or something like that. So I don't like to consume it that way personally, but I absolutely get that as a way for sports to. And by the way, I'm not even sure the NFL needs it, right? I do think there are other sports that really could benefit from this right now.
So I have taken the dive into, I don't know if they still do it, but Major League Baseball had the Strike Zone network.
Yeah.
And they would take you around, they would whip you around the league, and that was okay. It's just not the same. You know, you don't have constant action in baseball. It's a slower sport. Right. And the NBA tries that with their game time. With their game time channel,
but do you think for the reason you just gave for baseball makes that a more intriguing situation, right? So I'm only seeing the action instead of having to sit through seven innings to see two hits.
Well, that's the problem, though, is that sometimes they're like in football. There's always in a 1 o'clock slate with that many games. There's always something going on that
somebody's in the red zone. Yeah, I get it.
Yep. In baseball, that's still not always the case.
No, there may not be a runner on third for 4 hours. I get it. I understand. 10 minutes,
nothing is happening across the entire sport, and I mean that is part of the beauty of the sport. But it doesn't make for a good red zone channel type experience. But yeah, you're right. They're gonna all of these leagues ought to try it, and I think. Yeah, I think college football has flirted with this as well. The problem with college football is there's so many games that people don't care about. I'm obsessed with college football, but they span to some of these games in the MAC, and I'm like, I'm out. I don't care. I don't care what Akron's doing.
You're such an elitist, Brandon. My goodness. Pretty much. Just take the touchdowns when they come to you.
Okay. All right, let's be honest, fantasy is a big part of it too, and fantasy football is
if you were betting on the Mac, maybe you'd care about the Mac, Brandon.
That's like, you know what, you're not wrong about that. Jared Goff has bet on himself over the course of his career, and he is paying dividends for it. He is the latest in the long line of massive quarterback contracts. 212 over 4 years, 170 guaranteed is what was reported, but you've done your own work on this contract. So what are we seeing here? AAV guarantees. What are we looking at?
It's real. It's a real contract, and most of these quarterback contracts are going to come out this way, right? There's really no room left for fluff in quarterback negotiations anymore. So, boy, Goff really outkicked his coverage here. He really did. And I know that, I've put some tweets out. I put some data out there. There's some stats, win-loss records, however you want to slice this up. There is no version. There's no singular version of Jared Goff's resume that leads him to 4 years and 193 in change, which is the practical value of this contract, right? He's just north of 190 over the next 4 years before really a potential out is possible on this deal. So look, he's just benefiting from a lot of other really great quarterback contracts, and he's just the next man up. That's just what this is. I put out a pretty important tweet yesterday. I think maybe you saw it, that referenced the percent AAV of the league salary cap. Okay. So we talked about this before. Jared Goff's $53 million a year is based on the $255 million league salary cap, right? No other quarterback contract has that benefit. So Joe Burrow last year at $55 million was based off of a $228 salary cap. His percentage of that is much, much higher than Jared Goff. In fact, I ran every quarterback contract that exists right now. Jared Goff is 10th when it comes down to that percentage point.
Wow.
Which sounds a heck of a lot better than $53 million, second, you know, highest average paid player in football. So that's just what we're talking about here. The climate of the NFL financials has changed drastically, and Jared Goff has benefited from it. So what probably should have been around 160, 175 million over the next four seasons is now 193 and change. That's just where it's gone. And a lot of other players are going to get that kind of bump. And I would expect Tua to be next in line. It seems like that's nearing a conclusion based on from the tea leaves I'm reading. We're going to be sticker shocked. And this is why, because the league has boomed over the past 18 months.
Yeah. And wasn't some of this forecasted with the increase in salary cap from a few months ago? We talked about how this is going to change some of the way that contracts look. We saw this happen in the NBA years ago when all of a sudden the sticker shock didn't match the overall quality of the player, but it was because the structure of the league had changed in terms of salary caps.
Right. So we had a number, the league officials had a number kind of hanging out there. NFLPA had a number hanging out there in February. And then even some of the NFL Network reporters and Schefter himself were saying some numbers. And the actual final number came in well above all of those estimates. That's why I'm sitting here saying that the NFL is screaming out loud, we are rich. Okay. We are doing really well, guys. So if you're looking for a contract right now, push the envelope. That's what Jared Goff has done here. And you can't blame him for it. I don't think it's going to, you know, decimate the Detroit Lions' ability to be a contender for the next 2 to 3 seasons. He's got manageable cap hits, 27-2 and 32-6 over the next 2 years. They can convert in 2026 we're at $300 million by then easily in terms of a league salary cap. So you can say that it's tough to build around a quarterback contract. There's no question that's a fact because it does make other decisions tough. And there are certainly players that have to fall off rosters. But the league is bailing everybody out here, and that includes this Jared Goff contract.
So does this become the new, you know, there's a sort of benchmark that agents try and hit where their player looks the most impressive at signing, the percentage of the salary cap. Is that going to become, you think, part of that conversation where sometimes the focus is on guarantees, the overall guarantee? Sometimes it's on the average annual value, the percentage of the salary. Is that going to become part of the equation? And what is the most important, you think, for agents when they're structuring quarterback contracts?
Well, if you're talking about going into the negotiation, they're looking to hit every benchmark, right? And obviously the team is going to come back and say, fine, we'll give you that, but we got to take some back here. And there's obviously a give and take. You know, Jared Goff's agent is certainly not going to go out there talking about how he's 10th in percent AAV right now. That's not the look they want. They want the $53 million. They want the 170 guaranteed. Those are big time numbers in comparison to the rest of the quarterback contracts that exist right now, including what Patrick Mahomes and Josh Allen and all these other guys that kind of sit above Jared Goff in all the other rankings. I do think it's important. The entire NBA financial structure is built around that metric, right? In fact, it's how max contracts are generated, et cetera, et cetera. So the NBA has already adopted this as the primary focal point, and we've updated our numbers accordingly. We don't so much hammer on cap hits and tax hits on our NBA data. We're talking in percentages, and Keith Smith does a great job of laying that out, I think, on a daily basis when he's talking about these offseason moves. So it's something I'm going to turn to more with the NFL. Will it become a thing? Probably not, for the reason I just gave you. Agents aren't going to want to hang their hat on a situation that they're not winning. And it's really tough to win when the salary cap is bumping up 12 to 15 million every year. And you know, you're not going to see Tua get a $65 million contract, which is what it would be to match Joe Burrow. You know what I mean? That's not going to happen. If it does, now we know that is the metric, Brandon. That's the one that everybody's looking at and then teams are finally giving away on. But until then, that's probably the one to poke holes in most of these contracts with going forward.
Interesting. So that is something to look for moving forward. And Tua is going to be my next question, because once a quarterback signs a contract, it's always about who's next. Is Tua the obvious next man up, or do you think that there's a sleeper here, that another quarterback in the league that could slip in front of Tua and sign their own version of this mega extension?
Yeah, I said Tua because I'm kind of reading that it seems like it's getting close in Miami, but I don't know that Jared Goff's contract really affects Tua specifically, right? Two very different kinds of quarterbacks, two very different ages. This is Goff's third contract. Tua's looking for a rookie extension. If anything, this has only bolstered Dak Prescott's resume, right? Which is hard to do because he was pretty much at max leverage yet again, like he was 3.5 years ago. I just don't think anything's getting done there. And, you know, I just did a big offseason free agency outlook for 2025, and I said it there as well. It doesn't seem like the Cowboys and or Dak Prescott are motivated to get to a contract. So that would be the obvious, well, now look where we are, right, with Dak Prescott's numbers going forward in terms of what Jared Goff just did. But it doesn't seem like there's much legs there. So Tua, Trevor Lawrence are probably on the same wavelength in terms of where they were a couple weeks ago. But if you're a veteran looking for a contract extension over the next 12 to 18 months, this has certainly helped that cause. And it will help Dak Prescott in free agency if he gets to that point.
So let's look at some of those other names that you're talking about. The names on the horizon, 2025 free agent tracker, those sort of players that we're going to look at throughout the course of the season and then definitely deep dive into in the offseason. You did some work over this at spottrack.com. As you mentioned, Nick Chubb is an interesting one. He's going to be 29 at the end of the year, coming off of a gruesome knee injury. How bad does he need a productive season? Because if he's good, he'll be the best running back on the market.
He will. You know, James Conner might make a run for that. He's been pretty solid in Arizona, and they are probably looking to have a pretty darn good offensive season. So I put him in this conversation as well. And boy, if J.K. Dobbins can only stay healthy, he's now got an opportunity to thrive in a Chargers offense that, I don't know, is going to be run first. It has to be, because the wide receivers are kind of no-namers right now. Yeah. So, you know, those are kind of the names. I will say this, and I mentioned it in the piece. We just came off a really nice running back free agency where guys definitely went north of where I thought they were going, where I thought running backs could go in the current climate of financials. It seems like we're about to take another step back, you know, maybe back down to earth where we belong with this running back conversation. So while you're right, Nick Chubb could get a Derrick Henry type 30-year-old contract, it just doesn't seem feasible, A, with where Cleveland is financially, and B, with coming off this injury. I don't think the expectations are that he ever gets back to 100%, right? That doesn't seem fair.
Yeah, I mean, at this stage, probably not. We would have already been predicting his decline even if he didn't get hurt.
That's right. That's right.
But that's not an overly impressive list, so unfortunate for the running backs that are out there. We're going to get some, but I think we're going to see this. I do think we're seeing a bit of a renaissance at the position, but you still have some of the old heads that are entering free agency.
There's still a chance that we get extensions, right? You know, this is only the free agents. This is only the guys with expiring contracts. So we could see another McCaffrey contract. We could see another McCaffrey contract in the next couple of months, to be fair. I think he's earned it. I know he's got term left, but San Francisco kind of knows what's happening right now, and we could see that happening. Travis Etienne could get something in Jacksonville. He's been healthy now, starting to look like he's maybe the go-to guy for Trevor Lawrence going forward. So there's an opportunity for nice running back contracts to happen. Just don't expect it next March.
One of the names that just popped into my head, he's actually, it looks like he's on contract for the next couple of years, is Isaiah Pacheco. He's a guy that is dirt cheap right now, but he has been really productive with the Chiefs. The Chiefs haven't really been in the business of paying running backs, but he's a really good player. I wonder, he's not an unrestricted free agent until 2026, but I wonder if he could be a part of that conversation.
Yeah, I just don't see Kansas City going that route. They've had to make so many big decisions. That doesn't seem like one they'd make.
Right.
I my guess is they're going to run him into the ground and then make him somebody else's problem.
But I want to go back to Dallas for a second. There's still no timeline on the CeeDee Lamb extension, so it's not just about Dak. Yeah. It's also about Dak's number one. What are the Cowboys waiting on here? Because this one feels pretty obvious. Like, he is a top two, top three wide receiver in the NFL, right there in the thick of his prime athletically. It feels like this one, This is one that Jerry Jones would trip over himself to sign. So what are we waiting on here?
Dak, most likely. All right. Because I guess if we get to a point, or maybe the Cowboys internally have already gotten to the point where they believe Dak Prescott is going to free agency, I don't know that they have a plan B for 2025. Right. And maybe that's a draft pick, but it's not going to be a great draft pick. So they're going to look for what? The next version of Dak in the middle rounds, or maybe even the next Tony Romo, right? They've sort of been striking lightning with this position for a long, long time since Aikman. And yes, Trey Lance is on this roster. He's an expiring contract. Cooper Rush is an expiring contract. They have zero quarterback contracts for 2025 right now. I don't know how that can't be the driving force for every other decision that they're trying to make right now. So, and oh, by the way, their offensive line is aging, possibly retiring, moving on. So there's a lot of bad. There's a lot more bad than good with the short-term future of the Dallas Cowboys. And to me, that's not a reason to go and spend $300 million guaranteed, which is what it takes for CeeDee Lamb, for Zach Martin, for Dak Prescott, and a few other players who are sitting there looking around the room saying it's time to get paid. And oh, by the way, CeeDee Lamb himself is probably waiting for Justin Jefferson, who is for sure now engaging in conversations now that he knows the J.J. McCarthy situation and that Minnesota has at least built some sort of next generation for him to play and make some money in.
It's crazy. And if you're Dallas, just the way that their franchise operates and the stage that they're on, you can't bottom out. They have to stay relevant.
I think there's a very, very strong chance that Dak walks in free agency and that CeeDee Lamb is a tag and trade. It's kind of going to look like what Green Bay did with Aaron Rodgers and Devontae Adams, because Brandon Cooks is up, right? You can move on from a ton of the offensive linemen. You can move on from DeMarcus Lawrence. You got Trevon Diggs contract, and there's a couple of others, but you really don't have a bulk of contract and cash on your books after 2024. So it's actually an ideal time for them to sort of rip this bandaid off and try to rebuild on the fly. And maybe they believe that shopping CeeDee Lamb next March on a franchise tag is the right way, maybe even to get themselves a quarterback right in 2025. So it could be the exact opposite of everything we've been projecting for the past year and a half. They could be thinking subtraction instead of addition, or maybe even retaining what they have right now.
Yeah, just can't picture it. But it is a good wide receiver class next year with T. Higgins, if he doesn't end up signing or getting traded, Stephon Diggs, Nico Collins, Brandon Ayuk, Chris Godwin, and of course, we're all waiting on that Justin Jefferson contract. What about just without going position by position, is there another position group that stands out to you or that stood out to you as you were putting this together where you say that is a position of strength for potential extensions or free agency next year?
Yeah, addition by subtraction with these off-ball linebackers, right? These inside linebackers are some of the guys that really don't get to the quarterback too much. We're just seeing on an annual basis, teams are just letting these guys walk. Yep. And unfortunately, that's driving prices down, right? We saw Patrick Queen sign for, I don't know, maybe half of what I thought he was going to get and what his market value from a calculation standpoint says he should have gotten in Pittsburgh. So you've got, I don't know, half of the league's off-ball linebackers set for free agency, starters set for free agency in 2025. I'm not sure 95% of these guys get any sort of sniff at an extension. So big free agency for that. There's some named edge defenders, though that's a market that's always going up and down fluctuation-wise. And then it's this offensive line stuff, right? There's like 10 left tackles, starting left tackles for 2024.
That Ronnie Stanley name really stands out.
Taylor Decker for Detroit. I mean, there's a lot of names here. And of course, Tristan Wirfs is the class of this, maybe this entire free agency.
Oh, they're not letting him go. The Bucs haven't let anybody walk.
Right. But this is the biggest contract that they've yet to sign, right? So they're going to do it. They're going to franchise tag him at the very minimum. But he's going to reset the offensive line market by a lot, not by a little, by a lot, over the course of the next few months. He's on this list right now. So there's a very deep list. You could put together an all-pro list if you go position by position and just look at what 2025's free agency could bring us. And of course, that starts with Dak Prescott, who I believe will be there when March 14th or 15th comes around.
Go and check this out. It's an early 2025 NFL free agency preview. Can't get enough of the NFL. Go check it out. SpotTrack.com. Let's wrap up today's episode with our quick hits. A polarized sort of topic. So I'm going to ask this in a financial way.
Okay.
So as to
make
not
me answer, rile, huh? Going to make me speak to it. I like it.
Yeah, absolutely. We don't sidestep any topics, but the Chiefs have a tough decision. At least it appears to the general fan as it pertains to Harrison Butker. He made a fairly misogynistic sermon in front of graduating college students. And
yeah.
You know, I think the thing that makes this extra charged socially is the fact that the Chiefs in particular have added so many female fans because of Taylor Swift over the last year. And now they have this on their hands. This would be a big deal for any team out there. It's infinitely bigger for the Kansas City Chiefs, but happens to be one of the best kickers in the NFL. And he's a huge piece of the success quotient to the Kansas City Chiefs. So, two-part question. Do they have a tough decision on their hands? And how much would it cost if they made the ultimate decision to let him go?
First of all, the Chargers putting him in their schedule release Brilliant. Video is just, it's just next level. Because you know that they had this video going for, what, weeks?
Oh yeah, they had this in the bag.
And they had to go back to the drawing board and edit that sucker in, and it's just brilliant. Anyway, Harrison Butker is on the 2025 free agency list because he's on an expiring contract. He
right.
He's not non-guaranteed at just over $4 million cash, and he's got about $730,000 of dead cap. You can do the math. The Chiefs would save cap and cash to move on from him right now. He's also the third best kicker according to PFF last year. 90% of his field goals, nearly all of his PATs last year. And this is a position that is just becoming harder and harder to replace. So the answer is you just follow the money. You follow the percentages. You follow the stats. This guy's going nowhere. Will he have to speak? I don't know. The Chiefs have had a few of these situations. They are not, you know, blinded or isolated from this just because they're maybe the best team in the NFL right now. But you're right. The combination of Mahomes and Travis Kelce and their stardom, and now Taylor Swift, and my gosh, maybe the most powerful female in the world right now in terms of this generation, somebody's going to have to speak to this, whether it's Mahomes, whether it's the Chiefs themselves. They've come out at least a little bit and said this, you know, we don't condone this. This is not our view. I don't know if that's enough. The good news, I think, for the Chiefs is that it's May 15th, 16th. Okay. It's not September 1st. So there's a long summer for this to just kind of die down as a Friday news dump type thing and never come back. But we're in an internet sensation world, and it only takes a couple of things to bring this thing back around whenever it needs to. So long answer short, Brandon, they're not cutting them. The contract,
even though they would save money and save face. So that you do have two decent reasons to do it.
They would lose ball games. That's the end of the conversation. That's the end of the conversation.
You're not replacing him. And I agree with that. That's why it's a tough call, because you want to be on the right side of your fans.
I was there last year to watch Tyler Bass miss a field goal by 500 feet right and watch Harrison Butker make one to send them to the AFC Championship game. They're not cutting Harrison Butker, man.
I agree. It is so funny, though. My wife is a huge Swiftie, and so she's showing me all these TikToks of people that have watched only however many games they watched last year to follow along with this story. And they're breaking down his salary structure. And it's amazing. Like the way that, I mean, it is basically now SpotTrack has gone mainstream because of this. So you're in the mix. Okay. Just know that Donovan Mitchell didn't play the last two games of the Cavs series. They have been booted from the playoffs. Is he ever going to play for the Cavs again?
I do think so. You follow this stuff a lot more closely than I do, kind of being in the Orlando Magic world. I know he's headed towards an expiring contract with the player option for 2025 available. He's a ripe trade candidate. He was been rumored to the Heat and the Knicks and all these teams of importance. Now the Lakers, I saw this morning on the ESPN networks. I think it's much more likely that Darius Garland moves off this roster and that Donovan Mitchell extends his contract. So that's just how I'm reading this. Certainly trades coming, right? Whether it's Garland, Jared Allen, certainly with Evan Mobley sort of putting his foot down this series. It seems like there's a nice core there and maybe they have a bit of a surplus. So my guess is Mitchell stays, the coach leaves, Darius Garland leaves, and we see what the Cavs look like next year.
It's easier to trade Donovan Mitchell, I would think, just because he's on an expiring deal.
Yeah.
Where Darius Garland still has years left. So does that complicate things if you go that route?
Yeah, it might. Garland has 4 years left of a 5-year contract. So yeah, there's term there. There's also teams that need his services. And I know he's taken a step back offensively this year. You saw that in this series alone as well. But I just kind of think that the Cavs are a better team when Donovan Mitchell is more of a one-man band. It's a little bit of a Brunson situation happening there as well. So they'll find a way, right? We've talked about this quite a bit. There is no untradeable contract in the NBA. So Darius Garland with 4 years left on a $197 million contract is certainly within reason to find a trade partner this offseason.
Yeah, that's the thing I can't figure out with Garland is he overpaid? Or do we not know? I don't think we know the answer to that yet because he's a really good player. It's not like this is a bad contract, but I think he's slightly overpaid, but has a chance to meet that salary in a different situation.
That's fair. Yeah, that's fair. But I do think there are teams that would treat him more as a number one backcourt player. And then in that regard, he's probably fairly paid, maybe even a little underpaid when he started talking about guys approaching $60 million a year, which is where July 1st is going to take us this offseason.
Well, my Orlando Magic could certainly use the things that he does well, so yep. I would not write that off as an option. Let's wrap with LeBron James. He attended a Cavs game recently, got Bronny in the draft, and now he's at the draft combine overlooking his kid's performance. It feels like he's putting the pressure on the Lakers. Is he entering offseason strategy mode? We've seen LeBron do this over the years. I saw Brian Windhorst was just in all of his glory theorizing yeah. what this all means and yeah. what LeBron is doing to pressure the Lakers. Do you view it that way? Or is he just going to a basketball game or watching his kid in the draft combine? Is it that, or is it more?
This is one of those situations where I just trust Brian Windhorst. Nobody knows LeBron James more than Brian Windhorst. If you've done any work on this or at least heard the stories in the past, this guy has been with them since freshman year of high school. All right. This guy knows LeBron James. He knows how the mind operates. Yes, LeBron James was probably in town because he has a house there and thought, hey, it'd be awesome to go to this game. And also all the other things, right? And oh, by the way, I'm going to opt out of my player option and what a freaking mess it would make if I showed up on national TV 3 rows back, right? Front and center, not in a suite, not with other people, right? Just randomly there with a bottle of his own wine, right? This is calculated and probably recreational, but if Windhorst is saying it, I'm all in.
Yeah, yeah, fair. Check me out on my website if you need a podcast assist or audio production, content marketing of any kind. I can be your guy, AuthenticAudioPro.com for more info and detail on that. Hit subscribe and rate the pod and make sure you visit SpotTrack.com, a new feature on the 2025 NFL free agency class. Everything that you need in the sports contractual world can be found at SpotTrack.com. Even if you're new to the sports world, Swifties, you can go check out Harrison Butker's contract there. Mike, always a pleasure.
Thanks, man.